Okay, for almost all productions you do in the studio, you're going to need microphones or some sort of sound. There's a switch on the back side of this board that turns on the main source for making sound in the studio. Okay, we're in the studio now, and there's a couple things that make a studio a studio. The first thing is we have controlled lighting. And the second thing is we have all the wiring and soundproofing for sound. Now, the room is a sound, sort of a soundproof room. And if you look over here at the wall and in other places in the studio, you'll see microphone inputs that are tied into the audio board that's in the control room. Each one's numbered clearly. Like here we have 1, 2, 3, and 4. And these wires run all the way to the audio mixer in the control room. There's 12 microphone inputs in this studio already directly wired to the board. Now, to hook up a microphone, all you do is take one of these green cables, pick an outlet, plug it in, take the microphone, plug it in the other end, and you've got a microphone ready to do recording. When you set up a mic on a stand like this, wrap the cord around a few times so that people don't knock the mic onto the floor. If I knock that off, it's going to get caught and get dragged and pull itself down slowly. It's not going to drop immediately to the floor, but it's also, it keeps the mic a little neater. And any cables that are running in the studio, run them under the rugs or anywhere else you can run them out of the way of the talent so people don't trip. This stuff, don't just throw in a corner. Keep track of it, put it all together. This is the cable tie. Put it all in the box and put it someplace close to where the mic is going to be, or a place where all the mic boxes go. Okay, in addition to the microphone outputs in the studio, we also have video and audio lines. Now what this is just a point-to-point connection from here to a point in the control room, and that point is the patch panels. Basically, there's no direction to the flow of signal from the control room to the studio, which means we can feed something from here in the control room using the same wire, or from the studio out to here using the same wire. Now in this case, this box is labeled number one. So these are studio line number one, and this is a video line, and we have a right and a left audio line. Remember, the studio is stereo, so every video signal usually has a right and a left audio signal associated with it. Now, out here at number one, we have our computer hookup for faculty to present from. Now, in this case, we have a wire already made. We're going to take the audio signal from the computer and the video signal from the computer and feed it into the control room. That's what this setup is all about. And that's on number one. This could be moved to number two, number three, or number four in the studio. But these are just studio lines. Remember that they're here. All right. In the studio, we said that we have 12 mic inputs, 12 microphone inputs out there. Okay, that's the first part of the board, 1 through 12. Each one of these represents a similar number in the studio. Number 1 is number 1 in the studio, number 4 is number 4. They're all representative up to number 12 of what's in the studio for microphone inputs. I have a microphone that I dragged in here. It's plugged into number 12 out there. I don't want to confuse you. It's actually a long cable that's plugged into the studio on number 12. Okay? These are the master controls. Bring them all the way up. And this is number 12. I'm talking into it now, and you should hear kind of an echo in the background because there's a monitor in this room so you can hear what's going into the feeds in the other room. So this is the volume control for microphone input number 12 out there. Up above here is another volume control. It's actually a trim control or a gain control. And what that does is increase the sensitivity of the microphone. And what I'm going to do is turn it down a little bit. But basically it's getting louder and louder as I increase the sensitivity of the mic. If I turn it down, you can't hear me. If I turn it up, you can hear the echo. So there's, in combination, this dial and this dial are the volume for that particular input, and it goes across the board. You have one for each input on the board. So you have the main input, which we usually bring all the way up, and then we adjust the trim for the volume. That way we can lower it quickly if we need to, if there's feedback or something. The grays we're not using at all in this studio. For all practical purposes, we are, but I'm not going to get into it in this lesson. The blues are the equalization or EQ. They're like the tone controls, treble and bass. And if I turn all the bass down and I bring up the treble, it sounds pretty tinny, if you can actually hear that over my voice. And if I turn all the tones down and bring up the bass, you can hear that it's really deep. It's got a lot of bass tone to it. This allows you to kind of control the tone of the person who's speaking into the mic, or the tone of any input that's coming in. Generally, we keep it in the medium, straight up and down. Everything's equal. But your high end is on the top and your low end or your bass is on the bottom. So treble, bass. And it works its way down. You have four general areas you can boost, or by boost I mean you bring it up, by drop you lower it down. Clockwise you're boosting the signal, counterclockwise you're dropping it down. In PA systems it's used to control feedback more than anything. So you usually deepen the sound so you get less of a feedback, because usually it's the high end that causes feedback. Okay, the question comes, how do I know if I got a good, clean, solid signal? Now, I can adjust the sound in this room on just the speaker in the room, and I can bring these levels up and get good, clean signals, but I don't know if I'm getting truly a sound signal, and that's where this measuring meter comes in. Okay, what you want to do is make sure that the volume levels are peaking at the yellow and not going above into the red area. Okay, this is a fairly good sound level, good quality sound. It's not peaking too high, it's just peaking into the yellow a little bit occasionally for my voice. But if I start peaking into the red, and you can see that it's starting to peak into the red, that's starting to override the signal. That's distorting, and you don't want that. Yellow is permanently lit and red is just flickering. You don't want to do that with any of your signals. You want them to be in this range, and you want them up fairly high, because that's going to give you a good, clean audio recording. Don't trust your ears or your volume controls on your monitors or whatever else to make sure that you've got a quality signal. Start with your board. That's what this monitor is all about. It's going to tell you if you've got a good signal. I can adjust the volume on the speakers in this room to anywhere I want, but they have no effect on this actual monitor output, on this actual board output. I can turn it up loud, 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 and have my volume really, really low in the room and not have any signal. I can still hear myself fairly loud on the speakers, but I'm not getting a good, clean audio signal on the board itself. So one of the things you want to do is make sure that your audio levels are good and clean. We have a submixer here of different sources that I've patched into this board. I did up to number 12. I talked about how 1 through 12 are microphone inputs. 13, 14, 15, and 16, which are another set of inputs on this, are patchable. In other words, we can patch a signal in using the patch bay into this. We can patch a DVD player, we can patch a computer, we can patch other VCRs or DVD players. Anything can be patched into this board. Normally what we do is patch this other board in here, which allows us to use a keyboard, drum machine, turntable, CD player. So all those things are automatically patched into this submixer. So if I turn on this keyboard and I turn on this mixer, I look where it says keyboard and I bring that level up, that signal, which has been patched into this board, is already here. So anything that's already pre-labeled on here is, and when this board is patched into here, is a source on this using this extra board. I can play a turn record as part of this. This is an LP. This is old old school stuff. But it's still a media source. I can bring that in. Instantly. I can play a CD on this CD player. Just by bringing up these levels here. So I have a CD, turntable, keyboards, all fed into this board through a submixer, a premixer out here, that's patched on the patch panel over there. In addition, there's some other devices that can be patched into here. We have a cassette player, CD recorder, player. Those can be patched in as well. We could set those up to play in here. There's also reel-to-reels that we have that we can patch into here. Radio, we have a radio in here. If I want to talk over the music or talk while music's playing or do anything like that, I can mix that live. So that's what the audio board is all about. You can mix a lot of sources together. You can have more than one microphone, up to 12. And a whole bunch of other sources of information being fed into there to make your soundtracks for your live productions.